Good evening all, and thank you for the kind introduction. So we are a 450-bedded multidisciplinary, multi-organ transplant facilitated hospital in Krompet. That's the rest of the gang of cardiac sciences, five cardiologists, one surgeon and a cardiac anesthetist. So moving on, we all have a fairly broad view of what are the risk factors of cardiovascular disease and how to prevent it. So I'll be focusing my talk mainly on secondary prevention and focusing mainly on treatment goals as opposed to an elaborate talk about the treatment itself, treatment modalities itself. And I'll start by defining these three terms: secondary prevention, cardiovascular events, and who are the patients that we're targeting. So secondary prevention, we all know, as opposed to primary prevention, is the reduction of the impact of the disease after it's already set in. And what are these hard events that we are hoping to decrease the incidence of? They are together called as atherosclerotic cardiovascular hard events, or ACV hard events. They comprise of first occurrence of non-fatal MI, or death due to coronary artery disease, or a fatal or a non-fatal stroke. Cardiovascular disease, again, is a general term that's used for a condition that affects the blood vessels of the body or the heart, which includes but may not be confined to coronary artery disease, strokes and transient ischemic attacks, peripheral vascular disease, and aortic diseases. So this is the target population that we are hoping to modify the risk factors and decrease the incidence of ASCVD events. Anyone with an established cardiovascular disease, anyone with the diabetes mellitus or chronic kidney disease, or anyone with so-called metabolic syndrome, which is a constellation of abnormal obesity, dyslipidemia, hypertension, and insulin resistance, or patients with any of these multiple risk factors, or even if one is without any of these risk factors but is above the age of 70, will automatically become a high risk for this ASCVD events. Apart from this, there are numerous calculators available online which can download on your phones, which will give you an estimate of 10-year risk factor of the patient, the person whose data you have inputted, of him or her having a hard ACV event in 10 years' time. So if the risk is 7.5% or more, then he or she will automatically become a high risk for the ACV hard event that we saw. So these are the risk factors that we should be hoping to modify, and with a view to decreasing those events. I'll be going through them one by one, and once again, I'll not be concentrating on the treatment per se, but the goals of the treatment: dyslipidemia, blood pressure, blood sugar levels, role of antiplatelets, and lifestyle modifications. So starting with dyslipidemia, anyone with atherosclerotic cardiovascular disease and the individuals with a 10-year risk of more than 7.5% become candidate for treatment with statins. This recommendation comes regardless of the person's presenting LDL-C levels. So what it essentially means is that even if the LDL-C level is 100 or normal, if he falls in this high risk category, he should be there is benefit to be had by putting him or her on statin. There's no clear-cut target that's been agreed upon by authors worldwide, lowering the LDL-C levels below which it's got no additional advantage, but an empirical figure that most authors would agree upon is about 70 milligrams percent of LDL-C. This can be quite hard to achieve, I agree. Most authors would also agree that the lower the LDL-C levels, the better. Another type to treatment of therapy is to aim to lower the LDL-C levels by 80 to 120 milligrams percent from the initial presenting value. So these are options we have: statins, ISMIP, and PCSK9 inhibitors are still under trial. Just a few tips on starting treatment with statins. It's recommended that the highest dose of statin, adult dose, which is atorvastatin of 40 to 80 milligrams per day, or rosuvastatin 20 to 40 milligram, is taken at that dose, and you work your way up or down to whatever is tolerable, tolerated by the patient. Patients who do not tolerate one statin may tolerate another, so it's always good idea to try another one before stopping it or decreasing the dosage. When this estimate was indicated, if a patient cannot tolerate statin, or those in whom LDL-C level remains more than 70 mg/cm, even after starting treatment with statins, or in high-risk patients such as those with familial hypercholesterolemia, those with acute coronary syndrome, chronic kidney disease, or recurrent CVD events, or polyvascular disease. So, what should be the, moving on to blood pressure, the stress factor, what is the target blood pressure that we should aim to achieve? It's 125 to 130 millimeters of mercury systole and less than 80 millimeters of diastole mercury. Again, it's quite, can be quite hard to achieve, but it's worthwhile remembering that at least one randomized trial, sprint trial, has established the role of such rigorous intense blood pressure control in reducing the primary endpoints such as myocardial infarction, acute coronary syndrome, CVA, CHF, and death. Moving on to blood sugar levels, for younger patients, it's reasonable to aim for a target of HbA1c level of less than 7. And probably a little higher, less than 8 for older patients or those with limited life expectancy or multiple comorbidities. While deciding on the dose, it's worthwhile remembering it's always a balance between the risk of patient having hypoglycemia and the benefit that we are aiming to achieve in microvascular circulation. And unlike blood pressure, no RCTs have clearly shown an advantage of such stringent blood pressure control in improving macrovascular outcomes in long-standing type 2 DMs. What's the role of antiplatelets? Anyone with established stable cardiovascular disease or those with those deemed to be high risk recommended long-term aspirin therapy. Multiple RCTs showing advantage in terms of reduction of ASCVD events in these patients. The recommended dose is around 75 to 150 milligrams per day. Doses higher than 325 milligrams per day is only associated with increased risk of bleeding without per se imparting any additional advantage to the patient. And those who are aspirin intolerant because of dyspepsia or GI bleeding can try clopidogrel 75 milligrams per day. And these are the patients for who merit dual antiplatelets, patients who undergone PTCA with stenting, or those who have presented with acute coronary syndrome, or even patients with chronic coronary artery disease or cardiovascular disease with diabetes and low risk of GAP may also benefit from dual antiplatelet therapy. Key to remember is the second antiplatelet has to be continued at least for 3 months. Lifestyle modifications are as important as any of these other risk factors that we saw, and we should talk to the patients regarding modifying the same and trying to get the risks of ASCVD events down. I'll be running through each one of them quickly. So, diet rich in veggies, fruits, whole grains, less intake of sweets or artificial sweeteners and red meat should be encouraged. The calorie intake from fat should be ideally less than 10%, even 5 to 6%, and salt intake should be reduced to less than 5 grams per day or less than 2.4 grams of sodium. So this is the Mediterranean diet pyramid, which comprises of all the characteristics of the what I just described, but is unfortunately unpalatable to South Indian sentiments. Weight reduction, yes, we should encourage the patient to lose some weight and try to get them to be as close to ideal body weight as possible. The parameters to go that we can go by are body mass index, skin pore thickness, or waist circumference monitoring. Again, key to remember is it's easy to lose weight while difficult to maintain in that ideal body weight range. Even after stenting or CABG, after a month or so, we routinely recommend light to moderate activity, whatever the patient can do. So, by moderate intensity activity, we mean spending around 4200 kilojoules per week, which, if you assume they work out every day of the week, is 600 kilojoules per session. That will be the equivalent of moderate intensity aerobic activity for around an hour or half an have on all days of the week, or moderate to heavy gardening, regular walking for more than 40 minutes per day, along with recreational non-sporting activity for at least 1 hour a day on 4 days a week. So absolute smoking again is essential, it's not just cutting down. Also important to emphasize to the patient that the benefits of quitting smoking begins a few months after he has actually quit and reaches the person after only 3 to 5 years. So again, alcohol, if at all should be consumed in moderation. There are some studies which actually show that the intake of 1 to 2 standard drinks per day can actually lower the risk of CVD than in non-drinkers. And on that happy note, I will conclude. Thank you very much for your attention. I'll be happy to answer any questions. Stopping the thing.
The lipids are high. You have started correctly the statin treatment. The lipids have come down to the normal limits. Is there a role for intermittent therapy or the cessation of therapy?
We can stop for some time and see, recheck after 2 months or so. And then if they tend to go up, creep up again, it has to be restarted soon.
The second question is, the moderation of alcohol, which has been many times told by the
that is debatable.
Senior cardiologist, not only debatable, it should be totally removed from your mind, this procedure. Because the moderation never means moderation. Moderation never means moderation. Sorry for the comment.
No, absolutely right. Yeah.
Sir, we got the same point.
Yeah. That's correct.
For Westerners who take a lot of cheese, that holds good.
That's right.
In the Indian population, that statement that small amounts is good is totally wrong.
That's true.
So I think let us, as cardiologists, you should carry it, you should never say.
Recommend
that.
Sure.
When there is a contradictory, you should never recommend. Because that's what that patients go on saying that, and then they give that excuse, they take it.
Sure, that's correct, sir. Yeah.
So regarding the alcohol, the last edition of Alzheimer's, Alzheimer's product.
Yes, sir.
We'll go through this. 40 ml of alcohol, allowed for male. 30 allowed for female. We have been written in the last editions of the Alzheimer's. Present edition also, the same thing has been mentioned. This is what, you go through the Alzheimer's textbook of edition, you can find it.
No,
second thing, sir, regarding the statin, sir. Regarding the surgeon, if a patient has gotten cardiovascular disease, you prescribe arostatin or rosuvastatin. If it is a rosuvastatin, what is score over the arostatin? That's one question. The second question, previously people have been giving the aspirin for the preventive reason. Now they have included clopidogrel along with the aspirin. What advantage you get it when you add clopidogrel along with the aspirin? With aspirin itself is not sufficient to have a preventive cardiac possible incident.
Yeah, thank you. First question about what brand I would, which one I've used, atorvastatin or rosuvastatin. I personally prefer rosuvastatin because I feel the incidence of myositis and muscle weakness and muscle pain is probably less, no, again, hardcore evidence. But anecdotal evidence is there, and that rosuvastatin is probably better tolerated. And as a brand, I always gone for the research molecule. So I think my practice is to prescribe Resta, 20 milligrams to begin with, which is the equivalent of 40 of atorvastatin. The second question, dual antiplatelet, there is no, in chronic either be it coronary artery disease or cardiovascular disease, there's no role for second antiplatelet apart from aspirin, provide unless second antiplatelet is indicated only on certain conditions which I enlisted. One is patient has had acute coronary syndrome, or if patient has had a stent in, or if it's a high risk case, polyvascular disease, multiple episodes of DIA, or we tailor according to this thing. But for anyone with a stable disease, and coronary artery disease or cardiovascular disease, only aspirin alone will suffice. There's no additional advantage of the second antiplatelet drug. So if he's had acute coronary syndrome, for example, like MI or non-STEMI, then we should they should all get second antiplatelet clopidogrel. It can be clopidogrel or ticagrelor. There are some literature shows advantage of ticagrelor over clopidogrel. So that's up to us to decide. But for stable disease, aspirin alone will be more than enough.
I have a question here. About statin. Dr. Chalashev was saying that you can discontinue, but we do use statin for the pleiotropic. Right.
That's right. Yes, sir.
So even if the patient is normal epidemic, one would like to use in high risk cases for the periodic benefits. So that is one thing I just want to check with you. The second one is recently there was an article which was talking about lower LDL, lower than 70.
70, that's right. Yeah.
It increases the risk for stroke. Right. It's very recent, just about a week back.
Sure.
Right. So it's about less than about 50 of LDL had led to higher risk for stroke.
Yeah.
Right. So then that article was suggesting that somewhere between 70 to 100 is optimal. So what are your comments on?
So the first one was
first one is more for
regarding intermittent therapy. Yes. Yeah. So in practice we don't get to see this actually because even if at all we're thinking about dropping the dose or stopping it. It'll be on account of cost factors or intolerance rather than anything else. So I would not recommend stopping this thing. I personally don't know if it is recommended also. About the as I said, there is no consensus on the lowest level or a target level of LDL-C to work at. Most authors who agree up to date says lower the better. I have not come across this article stating less than 70 increases the stroke, but may well be so. It's a controversial area, the target to aim for. This thing that has been given is from the presenting LDL-C level, try to lower it down to by at least 80 to 120 milligrams per cent. So if it is like 200, get it down to 120 or below. Then the risk of the heart event decreases by about 50%, it seems. So that is one of the treatment standards you can go by. Thank you.
It was a finding. I just saw it 4-5 days back.
Yes, Facebook sent a news like this.
Not only the Facebook, I saw it from the.
It's called
Jacob. So it was published in Stroke, the Journal of Stroke. Some meta analysis of some 35,000 to 40,000 patients. They found that second intervention. When they had given very aggressive lipid therapy and statin therapy, they found that those patients who ended up with 30 cholesterol, LDL 30, 40, had a higher stroke, fatal stroke was higher. And possibly they are saying that there is a, the conclusions were saying that there is something like, once cholesterol is needed for the cell membrane synthesis, and that could possibly be the reason, that is one of the reasons. They say that there is an intracellular cholesterol level, which says at least 25 to 35 milligrams in the serum is needed to maintain an intracellular essential cholesterol level. So if it goes down to 40 and 45, you are coming to challenging the intracellular cholesterol level. So ideally, don't go below 70. Above 70, 70 to 100 is optimal. That is what that particular article, which is a 35,000, it's a big meta-analysis study, very standard. I think it is published in Stroke, the Journal of Stroke. It was published in the Journal of Stroke. So the possibility is that possible. This is what they have explained, but I don't know why the actual stroke is. That's why I was.
Yeah.